I sang that song for more than 60 years, a song of praise to Joseph Smith, the prophet of the Restoration and founder of the LDS Church, the church I served as a bishop for 5 years. I knew the church was true. I was a faithful Latter-day Saint.
My life has been built on certain truths, but wishing doesn't change the truth.
Jesus said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." When I finally learned the truth about the real history and doctrines of Mormonism, I realized that I was following the gospel of Joseph Smith and not the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have come to learn that many others have made a similar journey out of the bondage of religion and into an authentic relationship with Jesus. And that's what this show is all about. Courageous people who want to share their story, hoping that you, the viewer, will discover the same new life in Jesus. So if you're a Latter-day Saint who is struggling with questions or seeking a genuine encounter with the Savior, we invite you to join us tonight. We have a joyful message that we want to share with you. Hello, everyone, and appreciate you joining us for another episode of the Ex-Mormon Files. I'm your host, Bishop Earle, and again, we appreciate your time and watching. Hope and pray that the story message that we have for you today will really mean something. I'm really happy to introduce to you Sean Lawler. Thanks for coming down. You had a little bit of a drive, so I appreciate you coming. And
it's my pleasure
sharing your story,
Bishop Earle. I love your ministry, and I've been following you for a couple of years, and I just love your outreach, and it's really a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
Well, thanks. And we do try to be gentle in our approach and just tell stories and of people who actually have their lives have been transformed by what God has done in their lives. And I know
Absolutely.
That's happened to you in an interesting sort of way.
Yeah.
So tell us, first of all, where you were born and raised, and what's your background a little bit?
Yeah, thank you. So, yeah, I was born in rural Hyde. Well, I was born in Orem, but we moved to Hyde Park when I was very young. So
Hyde Park, where's that?
Hyde Park is in the northern part of Cache Valley.
Oh, up by Logan.
So, yeah, it's in Cache Valley.
Okay.
Moved there in 1966 when I was only 3 years old. So that's, you know, I was just a kid
now
there.
Now I forget how old you are.
Right. But I grew up there in that small town, and
a lot of LDS, I guess.
Oh, everybody was. In fact, I, to my recollection, don't know of anybody who wasn't. And kind of ironically, we weren't really active.
Your parents weren't active?
Yeah, my parents were not active, but I went to church because all my friends did.
Sure.
And that's the thing you did back then. And so, and I was baptized at 8 by my older brother, who is very active still, and he's a bishop. At that time, he baptized me at 8 years old.
Priest, huh?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Now, your parents do eventually become active and go to the temple.
They did, yeah. Uh-huh. Many years later, they've both passed away, but they did end up going through the temple and were sealed to us in the temple.
Yeah. So you learned all the primary songs. Did you end up going to Mutual much?
I did a little bit of that.
Scouting and
stuff. Definitely was involved in scouting. It was just kind of interesting because I was the only one in my family who was going, and you know, I, with the exception of my older brother, there's quite a few years difference between us, and so
yeah, I can tell if he was baptizing you, you're at least 8 years.
Yeah,
apart,
he was he's exactly 8 years older than me.
Yeah.
Yep, and then he moved out of the house when he was just 19, and pursued his own life and is doing very well, and he's happy. And
so you go through a period of inactivity, actually.
A long period.
Yeah. And in that meantime, you get married, I guess.
Uh-huh. I married my sweet wife, Delaine, and we weren't active at all. So my story is...
Now, is she LDS?
So she was LDS, but she also was not active. Mm-hmm. She was active right up through high school, maybe.
Yeah.
But she started having questions when she was in going through seminary.
Really? Oh.
And she just kind of fell away and felt like, hey, this isn't maybe exactly for me, you know? And although she had a great love and respect for you know, family and people who were involved.
Now, I've met and known a lot of even inactive LDS people, but I think they would maintain their Mormonness or the fact that they were LDS. Would you agree with that?
I mean, if
somebody would have said, well, what religion are you? You'd say, well, I'm a Mormon.
And that's exactly what I did do, because that's the only thing I had ever known.
Sure.
And I always thought, one day I'm going to go back. You know, one day maybe I'm gonna, you know,
New Year's resolution or something.
Yeah, we're gonna head back and get God back into our lives, and that kind of ended up happening. A really good neighbor and friend of mine started inviting me to come to church and
to the LDS church,
and I kind of put him off, and
I'm sure you were on that inactive role list somewhere.
And they, and finally I thought, well, why not? I'll just go, and I went, and I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
You know, and all our neighbors were there, and they were very warm and receptive, and so I went back. And although I was doing this without Delaine, without my wife, I just went. You know, and she would occasionally come here or there if I had asked her to, but it wasn't her bag.
Did you feel like you were coming home, so to speak? Do you feel that you felt comfortable?
Well,
you knew the message that was going to be shared.
Yeah. At that time, it did kind of feel that way a little bit.
I would think.
But as I progressed in going and attending more regularly, it got to the point where they were asking me if I'd be interested in considering going to the temple. And that was a big decision. And at that time, I had to make a lot of life choices, changes in my life. And I decided, well, you know, if this is true, this is probably what I should be doing. And I really wanted to set a good example for my children and my grandchildren.
Sure.
And so
And it's a big decision.
It was. Yeah. And my wife and I both took the temple classes.
The prep
class. The prep class. But nothing prepared me for that.
Did you end up going through the temple?
I did end up going through. I went through by myself.
Yeah.
Well, I went through with, you know, the ward members that took me through, but my wife didn't go. And that's when things kind of took a little bit of a turn for me,
what happened?
Well, I was without my wife. You know, I was without my family, and something, Bishop, was missing. Something wasn't quite right. Mm-hmm. I kept going back and going back and hoping that...
Was this with the Logan Temple?
At the Logan Temple, right?
Hoping what? You'd understand it or make it seem right? Or?
Well, I never had that real testimony that so many of them... get up and espouse, I know this church is true, and the burning in the bosom.
Yeah.
I wanted my bosom to burn.
And you read the Book of Mormon.
I did. I read it.
Did that help?
No, not really. I didn't really understand a lot of it. And in all the years as a Mormon, I don't remember, seriously, I do not remember once even cracking the Bible.
Oh, no. That's off. We carry it around, but we don't spend much time
So there. the only exposure to Scripture I had was the Book of Mormon and, Pearl of Great Price and the DNC. And I just wasn't getting what everyone else seemed to be getting.
Wow.
And I progressed through doing that and through several callings as well.
Well, I know you were a ward clerk. And
yeah.
You mentioned that you were a ward mission leader.
I was a ward mission leader.
But you were also teaching high priest sometimes, I heard.
Yeah, I was.
Just because of the age and more comfortable.
Yeah, there. I really loved those older gentlemen, and I felt very comfortable.
Now, was that teaching the prophets?
Yeah, teachings of the prophets. Teaching and we would, a few of us would take turns, and I probably taught five or six times, and had a really great experience doing that. But still, Earl, something was missing.
Let me ask, just looking back, did you sense, what was your sense of Jesus at this point?
Well,
you've been through the temple, you're studying, teaching.
Right.
Active, and what do you...
At that time, I knew Jesus died for me. But I really felt like I had to meet him halfway. I had to do my part. Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And that those works were important. Sure. You know. Yeah. I felt strongly that he was the Savior, but that I had to earn that love, or that I had to do my part.
Sure.
And because that's all I'd been taught my yeah. entire life.
Isn't that amazing?
And I never had the loving, awe-inspiring, warm, loving relationship that I have with him now.
Yeah.
And it's very different.
Now, you mentioned the burning in the bosom, mm-hmm. but you did bear your testimony.
I did.
And yep. did you feel like you were kind of...
I felt like I was doing
what was expected
of me. Yep, and I wanted to believe it.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted that to be true. I desperately wanted it to be true, so I was probably trying to talk myself into it.
Yeah.
But as a ward mission leader, I wanted to be really prepared too.
Yeah.
And I knew a lot of these, as they call them, investigators, or
right.
persons who are looking at becoming LDS, would probably have some questions.
Yeah.
And so I started kind of doing a little research out there, you know, and I came across a few things that really struck me as life altering.
For example,
one of the things were all the anachronisms that are in the Book of Mormon, mm-hmm. and an anachronism is an event that is said to have happened in a specific time frame that's impossible. It couldn't
right.
have happened then.
Mm-hmm.
An example of that would be horses in the Book of Mormon. The horses were brought over by the Spanish. There were no horses.
Right.
There were no coins. Mm-hmm. There were, the list goes on and on and on.
Yeah, yeah.
That was one of the first things that came across. And also Joseph Smith's plural marriages. I stumbled across...
You learned about that, huh?
I was never taught that.
I was never taught that either.
I didn't know that until, you know, 5 years ago was the first I heard that. And I thought, there's no way that could be true.
No.
And so I set out to disprove that, but
sure.
that led me down the rabbit hole even further.
Further study.
Yeah. But I'll tell you, Earl, the nail in the coffin for me
yeah.
was the Book of Abraham.
That was big for me too.
That's what really did it for me. When I found out that the papyrus were common funerary texts.
Yeah. Did you even know that the church had the?
I didn't.
The papyrus.
All that was new to me.
Yeah, I didn't even know they had it. I was on my mission when it came out.
Yeah.
And I just totally for some reason missed that whole business. So I was shocked. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was
quite a revelation for me, I kind of went off the view that the whole thing hinges upon the words of the prophets, and if what Joseph Smith was saying,
and the character of Joseph
right,
Smith, yeah,
yeah, if what he was saying wasn't true, then none of this could be true,
yeah.
And so I had to come to a place where I had to you know, figure this all out. And so what I did is I compiled a list of 8 questions, which I have right here.
Very fascinating. I mean, many of them are the same ones. Some of them I've learned
yeah.
since, but
yeah.
but you gave that to...
I did. I took my concerns to my bishop at that time, and he's a lovely man, and he's just doing the best he can.
Sure.
One thing about talking about these things is I want to do it out of a sense of love and out of respect.
Well, and I appreciate that because I had, as we've talked, and you'll eventually share, I had the same experience with my leaders, so please.
Well, I took
It's not
these...
being disrespectful, it's
yeah.
just what we as Mormons,
yeah.
it's our reaction to this kind of stuff.
And I was no longer the ward mission leader when I took him this information. I had quit the ward mission leader because of these questions, though.
Yeah.
And I was just hanging on by the nails here to even stay Mormon
kind
at this
of help me out here.
Yeah, and so I took these to him, and I'm like, Bishop, I have these real concerns here, and I've listed them all out for you, and the sightings and where I got this information, and I need you to help me understand these things. Yeah. And he wouldn't even look at them. He told me he didn't want to see them. And I said, Bishop, I said, this is my spiritual well-being here, and you are the spiritual, you know, shepherd of our ward, who has revelation and light specifically for me. I need you right now to talk to me about these things. And he couldn't do it, and he wouldn't look at them. So I just said, well, I'm going to just tell you one. I'm going to just... And I brought up the issue with the papyrus and
with the Book of Abraham.
And the explanation he gave me was very vague and esoteric and made zero sense.
But he heard about it?
He had indicated that he had,
somewhat aware.
He wouldn't have known many of the things because he wouldn't even look at the list.
Right.
But what struck me and where it ended right there and right then was he said, Sean, I know you've got these questions, but you need to kind of keep them to yourself. If you share this information with people, or you're out disseminating this or talking about this, then you might be looking at church disciplinary council or even excommunication.
Sure.
And I just told him, Bishop, I said, you don't even need to worry about that. I said, I am officially quitting. I am done. When I walk out these doors, it's over.
Wow.
And I never went back.
And it's so sad. I feel like, and I don't want to keep taking time from your story, but I did the same thing to a church historian, and also a friend that I had that was an institute director presented him with three things that I was having a problem with, and really no answers.
Yep.
It was really sad, and I was actually looking to, like you were saying, disprove these things that I'd been reading and hearing. Mm-hmm. So you ended up... did you tell your wife, I guess?
Oh, yeah. Well, we talked about it quite a bit, and my wife had noticed for that year or so while I was attending the temple and I was the word mission leader, she could tell that I was really quite unhappy. And she even would comment on it. She goes, honey, you know, what's wrong? You know, you just don't seem happy. And I would just tell her, something's missing. Mm. You know, I can't quite put my finger on it, and I just kept trying to determine that. But Delaine was not going to go where I had been. She had no intention of going to the temple.
So did you kind of go into a new period of inactivity?
Well, we just kind of fell... Well, shortly after I left, Delaine also... Because we talked about all these things, and I'd come
home...
And
she could see that, and she'd had problems anyway.
Oh, yeah, right? And I'd been studying this for months, and I would come down to her, and I'd say, honey, this is what I learned today, or can you believe this is
stuff.
True? This is what...
Yeah.
Why weren't we ever taught this?
Yeah.
And so she was ready to leave, too, and she submitted her resignation shortly after I did.
So what happens next?
So we go into a span of time that lasted about a year where we really wanted God, and we were praying, and we were yet still hadn't cracked the Bible, hadn't gone to the Bible yet.
Didn't know that was going to be
just help. Kind of, I was so indoctrinated against that, I guess, that it never occurred to us to go to the Word.
Gee whiz.
You know, and so... but a really good friend of mine who I've known for 30 years, a great guy named Marco Worthen, up in Cache Valley as well. You know, we go back a long stretch, and Marco, one time, we just in conversation, I asked him, you know, hey, you're a Christian, so how's that? You know, what's that like? And he goes, well, why don't you come to church and find out? And so my wife and I just went in one day, just kind of came in off the street. We didn't tell anyone we were going or anything. And Bishop, it was just amazing.
What church was that?
So it's Alpine Church.
Up in Logan.
And we came in and we just found us a little place kind of off to the side. And then this music comes out, and it's all about Jesus, and it's all about praise,
isn't
and it's
that
about
amazing?
Worship. And
were the words up on that?
They were, yeah. And everyone was so happy, and you know, people were praising him,
Jesus.
Right there. I mean, they're standing up and praising. People are crying, including us.
Yeah.
And
same thing happened to us.
Yeah,
it's so wonderful.
Yeah. Yep. And we just loved it so much. And we went right home and dusted off the big family Bible.
Is that right?
Got it out. Yeah. And now we get into the Word. She's got her own Bible too.
And you kind of felt like this was your new creature moment, wasn't it?
That's when we were saved.
Yeah.
I'm sure of it. Yeah.
Well, that's kind of the way we were too. It's a miracle.
Yeah.
Do you think the LDS, I know the answer to my own question, but do you think the LDS are anchored in God and Jesus? Or are they more anchored in the church and their own works and their family and that kind of thing? Because you see Jesus differently now.
Oh, completely different. And that's always a bit of contention when I try to talk to my LDS family and friends. They'll say, well, I'm being deceived. But I'm like, well, could I share with you? Could we talk? Do you want to talk about these things? Nobody wants to talk about it at all, really.
And yet you have a relationship with Jesus now never understood as Latvic was saying.
And it's real, and it's warm, and it's alive.
Did you ever understand grace as a Latter-day Saint?
Nope, had really no concept.
Because you needed to get to the temple, and you needed to
It was all works.
Yeah.
So when we think of Ephesians, you know, it is by grace. Ephesians 2, 5,
8 and 9
it is. Yeah. By grace you are saved, not by works.
Lest any man should boast.
And the part I love about that also is where it says, and not upon yourselves, but as a free gift of God. The gift of grace.
Fantastic.
You know, and the rending of the temple veil so that all can enter at any time, you know.
What a beautiful, simple story.
Yeah.
I always talk about the bad news and the good news, you
know,
because that bad news is this list of stuff.
It's
just impossible to support, but the good news is just overwhelming. You actually work on the soundboard now
or something. I do, yeah.
You really love the music.
God works. I'm fortunate and blessed enough to be on the sound team up in Logan, and now I get to take part in helping create that, and I get to work with the worship teams and have a real good relationship with all those beautiful people.
Well, you said something to me earlier, and it was something that really struck me. It was the first time you said that you'd really felt God in your life.
Yep.
So you would sense this, something's missing. Was that it?
That was it, yeah. Because I can tell you that kind of hole that I had the whole time I was trying to find God as a Mormon has been completely filled. And now it's overflowing, and it continues to pour out. And
I assume you have more than the big family Bible now too, right?
Yes, indeed.
We got a dozen of them sitting around.
Yeah, Delaine's got hers. I've got mine, you know. I'm that guy that's, you know, reading the Bible on break sometimes, you know.
And how long has it been for you?
So we've been saved for just over 3 years. So
that's
we're kind of new.
I'm new too. Yeah. You know, it's just a few years, but we're learning, aren't we?
Absolutely.
And it's joyful.
Yeah.
And do you sense that freedom that comes with?
Yes, I most definitely do. And I've heard some people say that, you know, you may have just wanted to drink coffee again.
Yeah,
or who offended, or the Word of Wisdom issues or what have you. And you need these works. Well, I try now to be the best person I can be because I'm saved.
Exactly.
Not to earn my salvation. No. I can do nothing. I can bring nothing to the table that is going to make him love me more than he did when he said he loved me by taking those nails for me.
Yeah. Nothing we can do for a free gift for a gift.
Yeah. And when he said it is finished, it is finished indeed.
And now you know who our high priest is.
Absolutely.
I think it's so funny that we have all these LDS people running around, me included, that were high priests.
Right.
What a pride.
Yeah, it is very, very, very true.
And I guess you've learned a little more about the temple, too,
and
what it's actually for rather
than
Indeed,
I have.
Yeah.
You know, it was always my opinion that the things that happened in the temple were were the true distillation of what happened in Solomon's temple.
Yeah.
But in reality, you know, we know masonry had a bit to do with it.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
Well, I know we're kind of running out of time. What mm-hmm. would you say to your family and friends if you had some counsel for them?
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I would just pour my heart out to any LDS person or anybody for that matter. Seek him and you will find him. And it's not hard when he says my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Yeah.
It's the truth.
Yeah.
And it is so freeing. You're not burdened down with all of the trappings of religion.
Yeah.
Because you are with and in him. And I would just pray, be open to asking questions. Be open to hearing the answers.
Mm.
You know, be open, because this is salvational. This is incredibly important. And I do believe that God draws his own unto him, and he will do it. But just listen with, and God doesn't want our works. God wants our hearts.
Yeah.
You know?
And what do we say to a leader that, I mean, first of all, must have other people, perhaps, that are coming to him with questions.
I'm sure they do now.
I would think that they'd want to say, they shouldn't be afraid of the truth.
Yep.
And you should either be able to dismiss everything you've written there and show why you're wrong, which I've been disappointed my family hasn't been willing to come to me mm-hmm. and say, okay, here, Earl, this is what you missed.
Yeah.
But nobody's done that.
Yep. My brother, who's the bishop, asked me, very, you know, tearfully even, why didn't you come to me with some of these things? And I said, Ed, if my own bishop, who has divine inspiration, can't answer any of these questions, how can you?
Yeah. Do you wish you had shared with them earlier?
No.
Or?
No. I really...
Have gone the way they're supposed to?
Yeah, I do. And I would share this information with anybody, anytime, yeah. now. And I would love to share it with any of my friends and family. But I would want to make sure, if I ever talk to any LDS people, because I really have a heart for LDS people.
Yeah,
I love them very much, because when I see these great people I work with and my family members who are in the church, I feel like they're the ones who are carrying the heavy burden, and they don't even realize it.
Well, and like we were talking about earlier, all these smart people that for some reason don't think critically about this kind of stuff. Well, Sean, we are out of time almost.
Well, thank
you. I appreciate you coming, and it was a delight to meet you and
to have you share
your story. And I'm sure it will impact a lot of people. When people hear that, they're going to be touched. And so we'll see you next time.